This week, our Brody File crew on the golf course with Donald Trump. How in the world did that happen? One-on-one with the GOP presidential frontrunner who's going biblical.
But the Bible is special. The Bible, the more you see it, the more you read it, the more incredible it is.
And he's talking about God.
Who is God to you?
I'd say God is the ultimate.
He's been a hit with evangelicals so far, but they have a concern.
They want you to tone down the insults a little bit. They think that they can get there to vote for you if you could tone it down a little. Do you see that criticism at all?
I do, and I can understand it 100%.
Rolling along with Donald Trump in the golf cart, on the 18th hole, and one-on-one. This is going to be one terrific show, the best. We're huge with evangelicals. The Brody File on Across America with Donald Trump next.
Wow! Amazing! Thank you.
And welcome everybody to our special show on Donald Trump. Look, he is the GOP frontrunner for president. Now, for some, that may give you some serious heartburn. For others, it's cause for celebration. But whatever the case, here is Trump's message for you. Deal with it. And that is indeed what we will do for the next 30 minutes, because we're going to take a closer look at the real Donald Trump. You know, that's the name of his Twitter handle. And as the billionaire seeks the GOP nomination, voters are going to get a better handle on who the real Donald Trump is. So far at least, we know this. He's strong, brash, bombastic, politically incorrect, has a healthy ego, and has taken the phrase politics as usual and thrown it out the window. We also know that voters will eventually want more substance from him. So, is he up for the task? Well, he's going to need to answer that over time. In the meantime, the Brody File will do what we do best, faith and politics. We spent some time with Trump on his beautiful golf course in Southern California. Now, I'm sure he would describe it as huge, terrific, the best. So, in the next half hour, you're going to hear Trump talk about the Bible, God, forgiveness, communion, the evangelical vote, the Supreme Court, gay marriage, his aggressive style, and so much more. We begin, though, with some faith talk. You know, Donald Trump isn't known for being a Christian who wears his faith on his sleeve. So for him to actually talk to us about the things of God is always enlightening. So here is some of that conversation that took place both inside the Trump National Golf Club and outside on the 18th hole as well. Let me ask you a little bit about your popularity with evangelicals. What do you make of it? I know you're asking others to say, who knows, but what's your take on it exactly?
Well, I love them. I mean, I am one of them in a true sense. I'm Protestant, I'm Presbyterian. I've gone to communion so often, and I love going to communion. I feel it makes me feel so good and so pure, which is hard for me to feel, but it makes me feel so good. And I just have a great relationship. You see that in the polls where I do so well with the evangelicals. And some people are surprised to hear that, you know, coming from Manhattan and being in the kind of a business I'm in, which is a very big, tough business. Mm-hmm. But my relationship with the evangelicals has been very special. They are very special people.
Mm-hmm. The Bible, you talked about The Art of the Deal, great book. The Bible, even better. Why is that for you?
There's so many things. Like, you know, you take whatever you want to say. There's so many things that you can learn from it. Proverbs, the chapter, never bend to envy. I've had that thing all of my life where people are bending to envy. And they're just, it's an incredible book. So many things you can learn from the Bible, and you can lead your life. And I'm not just talking in terms of religion. I'm talking in terms of leading a life, mm-hmm. even beyond a religion. There's so many brilliant things in the Bible. And you can read it over, and many people have done this, and they've led their life that way, but you can read it hundreds and hundreds of times. You know, David, they say great art, like the Mona Lisa. Some people, they look at it, and it doesn't look as great at the beginning. And then they'll look at it. By the time they see it many, many times, it becomes the most, they can't take their eyes off it. Mm-hmm. Whereas art that's not great, you look at it, it looks beautiful at the beginning, but you get tired of it. The Bible is special. The Bible, the more you see it, the more you read it, the more incredible it is, and the more you realize. It's like a great, you could say, I mean, I don't like to use this analogy, mm-hmm. but like a great movie, a great, incredible movie. Mm-hmm. You'll see it once, be good. You'll see it again. You can see it 20 times, and every time you'll appreciate it more. The Bible is the most special thing.
Let me tell you a little bit about the word on the street. And you and I, you know, we've talked before, and I can give it to you straight, which is this. The word on the evangelical street is there are evangelicals that really are interested in voting for you, but they want you to tone down the insults a little bit. They think that they can get there to vote for you if you could tone it down a little. Do you see that criticism at all?
I do, and I can understand it 100%. But, you know, I am a certain type of person.
Right.
And over the years, I've made tremendous deals, and they've been rough and tumble, and I've dealt with some terrible people and some good people, but I've dealt with some really terrible people, like our country is dealing with. If you look at who our country is dealing with, look at, I don't even want to mention names because, frankly, I'll probably, if I win, I'll have to be dealing with the people. At least I want to be starting off even where we can maybe get along. There are some that I think will come over because I think they say, well, he may not be perfect, but he is one of us, and he's going to do a great job for the country. Mm. And ultimately, you do need that.
Frank once, and that whole Iowa thing where, you know, you're asked about whether or not you've asked God for forgiveness, and you're like, no, not really, not too much. But beyond all of the forgiveness stuff, do you believe that it's important to ask God for forgiveness? How do you feel
about
that?
Well, I do. I think it's great. And I consider communion to be a very important thing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I go to church and I take communion, I consider that asking for forgiveness in my own way. Mm-hmm. And I do think it's a great thing, and I think it's an important thing, and it makes you feel good. And frankly, I view communion, and maybe I was getting a little bit cute and we were all having fun. And by the way, you will know, the audience, which was largely evangelical, right, gave me a standing ovation when I left. I got the biggest standing ovation of anybody.
Right.
And we were all having fun. I didn't know it was going to be such a big deal. And actually, it turned out not to be a big deal because the polls came out right after that and the evangelicals like me. So I was happy about that. But no, I think communion to me is very important. I think also, you know, somebody said, right after that, and I was talking to a very good group of people and a pastor, and they said to me that one of the things you've done a really good job on is raising your children. You know, my children are terrific children. They're doing a great job. They're hardworking. They did well in school. They went, you know, it's an important element. And to me, that's a part of the whole process of God and religion and study. And they've been terrific. So I'm very proud of my children.
Tell me about God. When I say God, tell me about God. Who is God to you? What are some of your thoughts on this? Clearly, you're a smart man. You're a smart businessman. You've contemplated this before, or have you contemplated
it? I say God is the ultimate. You know, you look at this. You look at this incredible. Here we are in the Pacific Ocean. Mm-hmm. How did I ever own this? I bought it 15 years ago. I made one of the great deals, they say, ever, this piece of land. I have no mortgage on it, as you, I will certify and represent to you.
We'll see that.
And I was able to, you know, buy this and make a great deal. That's what I want to do for the country, make great deals. We have to. We have to bring it back. But God is the ultimate. I mean, God created this.
Yeah.
And, you know, here's the Pacific Ocean right behind us. So, nobody, no thing, no, there's nothing like God.
When you're in front of these swarming, huge crowds, look, you got a healthy ego, newsflash, but does that feed the ego, or do you feel more humility? Do you feel a little bit more humble by this whole arena situation?
Well, when I fill an arena like we did the American Airlines Center last night in Dallas, it's funny, the people were so enthusiastic that it was easy to do. Somebody, you know, because I don't believe in teleprompters. If I would read my speech, it would be so much easier.
Mm.
And you never get in trouble, which is also good, right? But you read a speech, and you read it, and it gives, and then you leave, and nobody goes crazy. I give it very much from the heart. You know, the greatest speaker I think I've ever witnessed was Dr. Norman Vincent Peale.
Mm.
And he would speak, the power of positive thinking. He would speak so much, and he'd bring it into modern day life. He'd talk about success stories and people that were successful and became alcoholics and then they conquered it. Or he didn't so much discuss drugs because drugs weren't the big thing in those days, but alcohol was a very big problem. And he gave some of the greatest sermons ever. And he was just, period, regardless of sermon, he was just a great speaker. But he wasn't reading anything, and I grew up watching that. He wasn't reading, like, and I've had plenty of pastors and ministers that read. It's not the same thing. Norman Vincent Peale would get up and his arms would be flailing. And you hated to leave church because you wanted him to go on further.
Mm-hmm. Evangelicals who are thinking about voting for you but are going, I don't know, because we want to make sure that, or they want to make sure that they can trust you. What's your message to evangelicals? Because, you know, go back to 1999, the pro-choice thing, you know, and the whole thing. What do you say to evangelicals in terms of them, that you can believe that they can trust you?
Well, when a pro-choice question was asked to me many years ago, I was a businessman, it was never even asked to me. You know, it's something you asked, right. And it was never even asked. And it was just like, oh, and if you ever saw the end of that whole thing, it was, because it was one particular quote, and I'm a business guy. And I sort of said, I hate the concept. And I do. I hate the concept of abortion. Hate the concept. And as you know, I've changed over years. I mean, over years I've changed. But I think that in terms of the evangelicals, and I think one of the reasons I'm doing so well, I am a Christian. I'm a Protestant. I'm a Presbyterian. I'm a total believer. I believe in the Bible. I believe in God. And I think I will help them so much with this country. You know, it's very interesting. A couple of ministers and pastors, and I thought it was accurate. I shouldn't say this to you, but I thought it was pretty good. They said, you know, he may not be perfect, but he's absolutely the best leader, and he's absolutely the best guy to take this country out of the morass. Mm. So he is a religious guy. He does believe. He may not be perfect, but in terms of running the country, he's perfect. I will do a great job. And they said, and therefore we support him. Mm. And these were ministers and respected people and pastors. And I think there's a lot of truth to what they said.
That is Donald Trump here on the Brody File. By the way, for more clips from the interview, you know where to go. You got to head to the Brody File. That's the Brody File blog on CBNNews.com. All right, coming next, Donald Trump talks about the Supreme Court, religious liberty, and gay marriage. More on the real Donald Trump when we come back. And welcome back, everybody, to our special show on Donald Trump. Hey, you know, let's be honest for a moment. Who would have ever believed that Donald Trump would actually be leading the Republican nomination for president? Now, your answer might be, well, I'm sure Donald Trump expected this all along. Actually, not really. Let's return to our interview to hear that Donald address that and a few other faith-related issues like religious liberty, same-sex marriage, and the Supreme Court.
Did you expect this? I know you, when I've been on the road with you before, you say, look at the crowd, look at all of this. But did you really expect Trump mania, if you will, the Trump show, if you will, did you really expect this to be what it is today?
Well, you know, I always expect to win. I want to win. Right. And I've always had a nice habit of winning. But frankly, I never thought I'd be going and surging so far ahead of everybody. I never thought that it would happen this quickly. I thought maybe at the end, like a race, a horse race, where, you know, at the end there's a, you know, you win by a head. But the truth is, I never expected the kind of, well, you had 31,000 people in Mobile, Alabama. And I mean, it was an amazing evening. And then the other night we had, as you know, in Dallas, we had 20,000 people. We filled up a whole basketball, the Mavericks Stadium.
Yeah.
And it was a love fest. It was an incredible, a lot of evangelicals, by the way, and a lot of Tea Party people, and everybody was there. It was absolutely amazing. I don't think, just to answer the question, I don't think I ever thought it would be this big this fast.
Religious liberty, the Kim Davis thing, you think an accommodation should be made at some point? Another, this thing has kind of moved on at this point, but there's going to be other cases coming
up.
Yeah,
it'll go on for a while, and you're also going to have new elections coming up, and changes could be made, and lots of things could happen, but right now, we have some very terrible Supreme Court justices, and frankly, they should have at least had that as a states' right issue. And the whole thing is very sad. But you would think that maybe she could let other people in her office sign. But that's going to go on for a while, and you're going to have a lot of them go on for a while. It was a terrible decision to put her in jail, I thought. It was not good and caused lots of problems. But at some point, I guess probably other people will sign and you'll get it done. You know, at the same time, we are a country of laws, and the Supreme Court has ruled, whether you agree with these justices or not, Obama's put some real beauties up there. But that's always been a tough situation, and I think you're going to have a lot of other cases. You're going to see this go on and on, David.
Mm-hmm. What kind of justices would a President Trump be looking for? What do you want to see in a Supreme Court justice?
Well, I would like to see great scholars. They have to be great scholars. Probably they have to be within the law, you know, in terms of law background. You know, you don't actually have to be. And maybe we should do that because it hasn't happened in a long time. But I would want to see scholars, and I'd want to see very conservative people. I want to see people that love the country. I think we have some people that probably don't love the country enough. I want to see people that love the country and want to do the right thing.
Donald Trump and some of his thoughts here on the Brody File. You know, as the campaign rolls along, he'll need to probably go deeper on substance. But so far, voters seem to like what they hear. All right, coming next, Donald Trump, Muslims, and the president. Oy, the latest controversy and what Trump told us about Islam. Back in a moment. And welcome back, everybody, to our special show on Donald Trump. Well, look, in the last week or so, the media decided to have a field day in their attempt to rough up Donald Trump when the following happened recently at a town hall meeting in New Hampshire. Have a look.
We have a problem in this country. It's called Muslims. We know our current president is one. Right. You know he's not even an American.
We need this
first
question.
Certificate, man. First question. But anyway, we have training camps growing where they want to kill us.
Mm-hmm.
That's my question. When can we get rid of it?
We're going to be looking at a lot of different things.
Well, you know, the media didn't like that answer, but here's the reality. Why should Donald Trump defend President Obama's faith? I mean, do you think the president would actually defend Trump's faith? Plus, the media ran with the storyline that Trump is looking at a few things to do with all the Muslims in the country. Hey, that's not what he said. He was actually responding to the Muslim training camps that have reported to be in the United States. Oy gevalt. Anyhow, let's delve into the subject of Islam a little bit more. You know, in our first interview with Trump, we asked him actually about all of this and the so-called peaceful religion.
You said one time in an interview that there, and just recently, that there's a, you said on O'Reilly actually, there's a Muslim problem in this world. What do you mean by that exactly?
Well, Bill O'Reilly asked me, is there a Muslim problem? And I said, absolutely yes. In fact, I went a step further. I said, I didn't see Swedish people knocking down the World Trade Center. And, you know, it was very interesting. I thought that was going to be a controversial statement. And somebody, I think it was Dennis Miller, when they introduced me him, he was doing like an analysis of my interview. He said, I love it. The guy said, what the truth is. He didn't mince his words. He didn't say, oh, gee, no, there's not a Muslim problem. Everybody's wonderful. And by the way, most Muslims are wonderful people. But is there a Muslim problem? Look what's happening. Look what happened right here in my city with the World Trade Center and lots of other places. So I said it, and I thought it was going to be controversial, and actually it was very well received. I think people want the truth. I think they're tired of politicians. They're tired of politically correct stuff. I mean, I could have said, oh, absolutely not, Bill. There's no Muslim problem. Everything's wonderful. Just don't forget. Just forget about the World Trade Center problem, blah, 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 blah. You know, but you have to speak the truth. We're so politically correct that this country is falling apart.
Donald Trump talking Islam on the Brody File. All right, back in a moment with our Best of Donald Trump segment.
Wow! Amazing! Thank you.
And welcome back, everybody, to our show on the real Donald Trump. Look, folks, we've interviewed him 6 times now. I mean, we're having a hard time keeping track. Let's pop up some of those interviews. Can we do that on the screen? There it is. Started back in 2011 at Trump Tower when he was thinking about running for president. And since then, we've interviewed him down in Florida, twice in D.C., and New York again. I mean, we love sitting down with him because unlike your typical politicians, he's not going to give you talking points. I mean, he's going to speak right from the heart. I mean, how could you not love that? So here is some of our Best of Donald Trump clips through the years.
I understand a lot of people send you Bibles. Is that true?
Well, I get sent Bibles by a lot of people.
Where are all those Bibles? You have a lot.
Well, actually, we keep them in a certain place, a very, very nice place. But people send me Bibles. And, you know, it's very interesting. I get so much mail. And because, like, you know, I'm in this incredible location in Manhattan, you can't keep most of the mail you get. There's no way I would ever do anything to do negative to a Bible. So what we do is we keep all of the Bibles. I would have a fear of doing something other than very positive. So actually I store them and keep them and sometimes give them away to other people. But I do get sent a lot of Bibles.
Very interesting.
And I like that. I think that's great. The Tea Party, I think, loves me because I tell it like it is. I talk about our country being in decline. They don't want to hear that. Mm-hmm. But unless you know about it, you're not going to be able to do anything about it. I talk about China ripping us. I talk about all of the things that's happening with energy and energy. We could be self-sufficient in energy. We don't need OPEC. We don't need anything. And yet we're not allowed to take the oil out of the ground. We're not allowed to go after natural gases. We're not allowed to do what we can do. We would be in a period of wealth like this country has never seen if we were allowed to just sort of let go, get rid of regulation. I look at the regulations in this country. As a builder, you build a building, environmental impact statement. Sometimes it takes 10 years before you can build. And then, by the way, at the end of the 10 years, they say no, because there's a piece of grass that is going to be disturbed. And I'm being totally serious about that. A piece of grass is going to be disturbed, and there's not that much of it. So you have to keep thousands of people out of jobs. You have to stop building housing, et cetera, et cetera. And other countries see this, and they watch this, and they laugh.
We have to make America rich again and make America great again. You can't do it without making it rich. Mm. And right now, China's taking all our money, and others, many other countries, Mexico, Japan, many other countries are taking our money. Saudi Arabia, they make $1 billion a day, and they don't pay us anything for protection. They don't pay us anything. And they would if we had the right messenger. Mm-hmm. And then when we have a meeting, last week the president had, they won't even show up to the meeting. They tell them we're not coming, or we're not having the king. So give me a break. So we'll make our country great again.
Donald Trump through the years here on the Brody File. All right, we're back next with a classic Donald Trump moment. See you in a moment. All right, welcome back, everybody. Hey, look, before we leave you, we have to show you this classic moment with Donald Trump on the golf course. Now, his critics love to bash him because they think he has no love in his heart for immigrants. Well, Trump says nothing is further from the truth, and he wanted to prove it to us as our cameras rolled. Take a look.
These are great people. They've been with me for 15 years. They're fantastic. Tell them where you're from.
I am from El Salvador. In Guatemala.
And do you like working for me?
Yeah, we like you.
Yeah. Ah? These are great guys. And I have thousands of Hispanics that work for me, and they love Trump, right?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Thanks, fellas.
That is classic Donald Trump. Love him or hate him, he is certainly entertaining. Nobody thought he'd ever be the frontrunner for the GOP nomination, but one thing about Donald Trump, he's a fighter. He knows the art of the deal because, well, heck, he wrote it after all. So now we just sit back, relax, grab some popcorn, take a seat, and watch how the real Donald Trump saga plays out. I'm David Brody in Washington. God bless everybody. Have a great week.